listen.
Lost heaven, West Jamaica, sure is a mountain shining down the river. All my friends there, pulling on those reeds, younger than the mountain, going like a bee.
Good morning. Woo. Yeah, sorry guys. I put 9:30 a.m. on the schedule just so I could have some extra time, make some coffee, get everything set up. Got some cool stuff to show you. So yes, new music. That was actually Toots and the Maytals. Their version of John Denver's Country Road. And so the heavy news this morning is the lead singer, Toots Hibbert, passed away, age of 77. So that was dedicated. This whole stream is dedicated to Toots. So I know we have a couple reggae fans in the crowd today. So welcome, welcome. I got my coffee, I got my water. I should be good. Billy Joe Churchwell. Thank you, Billy Joe Churchwell. It's coffee time. I probably should be having this much coffee anymore. I'm starting to get my ulcer stuff back again, but why not? This is it's a latte. I made a latte with my Nespresso machine. So, yeah. Toots Hibbert. I got a chance. I was lucky enough to see him play. When was this? Probably like early 2000s. When I was touring with the reggae band Inner Circle, we did a show with Toots and the Maytals, Yellow Man. I think that was it. Well, we played at in St. Petersburg, Florida, at a place called, at the time it was called Janice Landing. I think it's called Janice Live now or something. It's a nice club downtown St. Petersburg, Florida. Do I have any Florida peeps in the audience that have been to Janice Landing? Anyways, this was probably like 2003, 2004-ish. And I think Toots was headlining. So it was like Yellow Man, Us, and then Toots, I think. I can't remember. But I remember watching his show, and it was really awesome. It was cool because I remember he was, you know, he was not a young guy. I think at the time he must have been probably 60. But he was wearing like some of the coolest like leather clothes, sunglasses, really kind of hip stuff. And put on a good show. Really good singer. Really good band, too. Root Tech. Jesse Root Tech. Toots and Yellow Man in Inner Circle. That would have been an amazing show. It was a fun show. I remember because, I mean, St. Peter's. So we drove from Miami in a bus to St. Petersburg, which isn't that far. It's only like, I don't know, 4-hour drive maybe. And so it was easy. We got to hang out. Got to see the show, come back. I think we actually played in Key West the next day, so I can't remember how we did it. But it was like a little Florida run that weekend. But I'm trying to think who else. I want to say somebody else played. I can't remember. If I'm sure the guys from Inner Circle remember. Marky FX is in Clearwater. Seen several shows at Janice Landing / Live. I think it's called Janice Live now, right? I think, at least for the longest time that I knew it, in the 90s and early 2000s, it was called Janice Landing. North Carolina, family in Stewart and Deerfield, yes. I've gone surfing in Stewart and Deerfield. Bom dia, saludos, Sao Paulo. I love Sao Paulo, Brazil. I've spent a lot of time there. Just wanted to say hi to all the folks that came early. Don't forget, if you're just watching in the replay, I'll put timestamps down in the description. Mickey Settlemyer, good morning, Matt Delahunt. Sorry I'm late, guys, to my Australian buddies. 9 a.m. seems a little too rushed for me, because I wake up at 7. Got to feed the dogs, do all this stuff, take them out and all that, walk them and whatnot. And then I got to have my breakfast, and then I got to set up all my camera and lights and prepare for the stream. So a lot of times I'm rushing to, I was rushing today, but I'm usually rushing to make it at 9 a.m. So lately I've been scheduling it for 9:15. And today I scheduled it for 9:30, but I got up early. I was up at like 6, so I got some time. Sammy, Chris, Rotal, Painkiller. Y'all, if you don't know, Painkiller bought one of these. Let's show it off, Painkiller. I hope you got yours. I know for a fact, because Painkiller told me on Instagram that he got one of these, just delivered this week. So congratulations to Painkiller. We were talking about it on Instagram. He posted the photo, and I told him, you know, now you know that the pink on the pick guard does not show up on video. It doesn't show up on photos real good. So now he can actually see what it looks like in person. So it's like extremely, if we could describe it, it's like extremely bright. Anyone that's seen it too, it's extremely bright, and that's probably, it's almost like it's like a neon sign. It looks like it's glowing, like there's a light behind it. But I think that's one of the reasons why it doesn't show up in photos that well. All my mods, Ben and Bent Tom, are here. At least two of my mods. Fast forward. Tyus, Chris Miller, Matt Harrison, here you are. Krenar. Painkiller, the only thing I ever shred is my cheese. Noted. Okay, let's fast forward. Terry's 3G's here. Gosh, I'm far behind. Okay, I think I'm all caught up. Painkiller says it's almost fluorescent. Yes. What else do I want to talk about today? Oh, I hope all my friends on the west coast of the continental U.S. are doing okay. I know there's a lot of fire. There's a lot of smoke. And I hope everyone is safe. I know beyond the fires, the smoke can be a problem for people with asthma and all that stuff. So stay inside if you can. Stay safe. 10 Solo Music is here. I just I finished a video for a new guitar that 10 Solo is carrying, and that will be out soon. Maybe not next week, maybe the week after. Studio Jamil, extremely bright, so the opposite of him. Michiel, everyone. What's your nickname? Like the Belgian hurricane. I don't know what to call you. Alan McDonald, has RJ ever met Yngwie? You know what? I've never met him, but I've seen him driving in Miami. Because you can't miss him. Yngwie has like a collection of Ferraris. And he's got, at the time, he had a white Ferrari. And, you know, it's a stunning looking car. So you look over and you see this guy with long hair and sunglasses and all these watches and chains. And like, oh, that's Yngwie. Yngwie, I don't know if he still lives there, but he was living in North Miami. And one of my good friends who lives in North Miami would always like drive me by his house and say, look, that's where Yngwie lives. And then there was a red Ferrari in the driveway. And I'd be like, oh, okay, I believe you. So I don't know where it is, but I remember driving by his house. And it was just like a normal looking, you know, suburban house in North Miami. Really nice. Hey, Mike from CGS is here. Good afternoon to you. Chris R., bad fires out here, but safe. Good to know. Man, Vancouver, Washington, it's big time smoky. Yeah, my sister, is Teresa here? My sister posted something about how Seattle has the worst air quality like in the world right now or something. So, which is crazy because every time I would go to Seattle, my sister used to live in Seattle, and every time I would visit there, I would be so refreshed because the air was so nice, because I was, you know, I was living in Florida, and then I was living in LA, and then to go to Seattle, when it's nice out, when it's not on fire, the air was amazing. And so to picture it having the worst air quality now is just, it's insane. So today, I wasn't planning on going live today. I told my wife, you know what, I think I'm going to take the weekend off, and she said, nope, you have people that want to see you every Saturday morning. And I'm like, you're right. So Christina's, it's all Christina's fault. She is my number one fan. And she appreciates all of you guys. So thank you for joining me every Saturday. Hope you're drinking coffee. Cleveland Browns fan in the house. BC Rich, if I had $20 million, I'd live in a giant hollowed-out Dumblehead. Tight spaces. That's probably about the size of a New York a Manhattan apartment nowadays. Thank you, RJ's wife. Yes, she might be watching. I'm not sure. I think we just got a package delivered. So, I didn't have anything to talk about. If you follow me on Instagram, you might have seen me post the new guitar that I got, which I'll get to in a minute. But everyone's thanking my wife. I don't think she'll want to come down and be on camera and say you're welcome, but I'm sure she does. She might yell or bring down the dogs. If the dogs want to come down, dear, if you're watching and the dogs want to come down, but I think they're sleeping. Today, so I made a thumbnail, the shreddier the better. I had no subject. We can talk about whatever you guys want to talk about. Ask me questions, that's right. If you guys have any questions or you want to donate or whatever, I'll put the, no, that's not it. What am I doing? Here we go. The ticker, everyone, the pink ticker, if you can see this. Welcome, enjoy the chat. Super chat if you want my attention. If not, make sure you at least hit the at symbol and then tag me so I'll see it. What was I going to say? I'm totally lost what I was going to say. Yeah, so if you have any questions, I'll answer them. Today's kind of loose. I don't really have a subject to talk about. Hey, Emery Geyer from 10 Solo is back. Switched accounts. Okay, now I know who you are. If you guys want to check out some cool products, some cool pedals, some cool guitars, check out 10 Solo Music. He sells like really interesting brands, not your typical brands. You've seen some of them, like the MG Music pedals that I've been demoing, some guitars as well, some Volas and Acacia guitars. Bent Tom, when is your 80s rack arriving from LA? Man, I'm gonna be honest with you. I went on Reverb and pieced out just what I would need to make an 80s style rack. And those things are expensive still. I mean, A, you can't get... I can't find the Tri-Stereo Chorus. You can... There's some guys that... Like, Full Tone makes reproduction. I think there's another company that makes a pedal-style Tri-Stereo Chorus. But I haven't found them on Reverb or eBay. Everything, even the Rain Mixer that they used... The Rain Mixer that they used is expensive. So, yeah, that's not going to happen. Because I don't see myself spending tens of thousands of dollars on gear from the 80s that is just to get a sound that... I mean, realistically, you can create these sounds with plugins and a Helix or a Kemper, so... Ron Woodruff... Thank you, Rod. Rod, I said Ron. That's because my name is Ron. What is your preferred method of noise control for effects and single coil hum? Good question. I was thinking about last night when I first got my first guitar, which was the blue Strat that you've seen. And I remember taking it back or taking it to my local music store, which was Joe's Music in Detroit, and telling Joe that my guitar makes too much noise. It's humming and buzzing. What can I do? And he said that you could either put humbuckers in it, route it out. This was the mid-80s at the time. So you could either route it out, put humbuckers in it, or you could use these new pickups that Seymour Duncan just released called Live Wires? Was that called Live Wires? They were basically active pickups. I believe it was like Seymour Duncan's response to EMGs. But they looked like EMGs. They were just flat black, no pole pieces showing. Took 2 9-volt batteries to run the three pickups. So 18 volts for some reason. And somehow they were able to fit those batteries in the stock cavity of the Strat without routing anything out. It was tight and it was messed up, but he fit them. And then I had noiseless pickups. They were super hot, like hotter than any humbucker, like super, I can't even tell you how much of a boost it was. But I remember playing through my Mesa Boogie amp, and it sounded better. The distortion on the Mesa Boogie sounded better with these active pickups than it did with like the humbuckers in my Ibanez, which was weird. And it's because they were so super loud. And I used those through college because I didn't know anything really about pickups. I just like, hey, these are silent. It's a Strat. It sounds like a Strat, but... As far as nowadays, it's a lot easier. So for to remedy single coil hum, there's so many great noiseless single coil pickup manufacturers out there. DiMarzio, Seymour Duncan, Mojo Tone. You can get the Fishman stuff. They all sound a lot better than they did 30 years ago. As far as noise from effects, I don't use a noise gate. You can, though. Especially if you do a lot of high gain with, like, digital effects and you have too much buzzing. The only noise gate I ever bought was the decimator pedal, which is that silver thing. It wasn't cheap. I remember it, you know, for what it was, but it was a really good, easy to dial in noise gate. But I don't use them. It kind of messes with my mind knowing that if I don't pick past a certain volume, it's not going to attack the same way I want it to attack. So I rarely use noise gates. Maybe if I'm recording and using high gain stuff, I might use a noise gate in the box, like in my plugins or something. But yeah, that's all I do. So good question, and thanks for the super chat donation. Rockin' Chango, I see you. Appreciate that, Rockin' Chango. Ben Tom knows everything about pickups. Lawler, Fralin. I think you're a big Fralin fan. Fralin has those pickups that are like, they're not Z coils, but they're like two blades and they're kind of like, they don't touch. I don't know what they're called. But I played them in a Telecaster once and they sounded pretty good and they were noiseless. Someone's asking, Nick Nerdinos, I remember you from last week. What do you think of Brian May? I think he's an amazing musician, guitar player, astrophysicist. I really like his style. I like the way how he developed his sound by building just a crazy guitar with his dad. And that became basically his sound to this day. And if you think about it, there's not a lot of players, even the gear he used where he just, you know, treble booster into a cranked Vox AC, multiple Vox AC30s to get that violin tone. There's not a lot of players that even dared to copy that rig or that setup that I can think of because, you know, he's just got that distinct tone. You think about other players like Hendrix and Stevie Ray Vaughan or Clapton, and millions of people are copying those setups and rigs with the Dumbles and Marshalls and whatnots and the whatnots. But like, I feel like people have a certain unspoken respect for Brian May's thing, you know? Because you can't just show up with, you know, a Brian May guitar and a cranked AC30 and not get called out for being a, you know, oh, you're just trying to sound like Brian May. That would be an interesting thing to try out. If I could get a Brian May guitar and a real AC30 and a treble booster and see if I could create that stuff. You think I could? All right, guys. So, Shreddy guitars. I've had a hit. What is a Shreddy guitar? What do you guys think a Shreddy guitar is? Let me get this ticker off so you guys know what I'm talking about. To me, a Shreddy guitar has sort of changed from, let's say, the 80s to now. For me, and let me know what you guys think. A Shreddy guitar has to be... maybe 95% of the time a Shreddy guitar has to be a Strat style body. What do you guys think? Did I just open up like a big can of worms? When I think of Shreddy guitar, it's a Strat style body. You know, in the 80s, even today. I think of it in the 80s, a flatter radius. So we're talking about at least a 10-inch radius, up to 16-inch radius. Really flat radius, medium jumbo to jumbo frets. I would say at least one humbucker. I mean, you can think, yeah, there's Yngwie Malmsteen, he's like the prototypical shredder, and he doesn't have a humbucker. But he's got scalloped frets, and I think that makes up for it. I don't think it needs a Floyd Rose necessarily, but I do believe some sort of trem kind of makes it a shreddy guitar to me. Then that's not totally true, and I'll show you one of my other guitars in a second. Yeah, I knew I was going to get somebody talking about a V or an Explorer. Floyded. I like how Floyded is a verb now. The Juggernaut. My wife Angela finds you the least annoying YouTuber. Thank you. Thanks for making my Saturday morning so domestically peaceful. That's awesome. I appreciate that, Juggernaut. I'm going to put this on the screen for a little bit so people can realize that I'm the least annoying YouTuber. I can only imagine what other YouTubers you watch. Is if Stevie T is in the mix. I watch Stevie T, and my wife will say, oh, you're watching that annoying guy again? But I think that's the whole point of his shtick, if you will. Stevie T we're talking about. Is he's annoying to people that don't get it. And I don't totally get it, but I find it entertaining. I can only take so much, but I do find Stevie T's stuff entertaining, at least from an editing standpoint. Rhett Schull is here. I'm not a doctor, but I play one on YouTube. Everyone, Dr. Rhett Schull, Professor Rhett Schull is here. He's got a live concert this evening, so make sure you tune in to Rhett Schull's channel. Another Backstage Live is upon us this evening. Let us know the time. I believe it's 6 p.m. Eastern, but I could be wrong. I feel like last time it was like 5 p.m. Eastern or something. So I do not know. But everyone go follow Rhett and make sure you tune in tonight. As well as, you know, there's a host of other great YouTubers that stream on Saturdays in the evening. Steve from Boston, I don't know if you're here, Steve. I believe Robert Baker, too. Robert Baker streams a little later than my bedtime sometimes, so. Okay, so we're talking about shreddy guitars. We left off at trems. I believe that it should have at least a Fender tremolo. It doesn't have to have a Floyd, but you need something that goes wah, 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 wah. But not all the time, because I'll show you in a minute. So, and that's it. And I feel like the pickup should be on the hotter side, medium to hot. You can't do the shred thing necessarily. I guess you can, and it brings me back to Yngwie, but you can do the shred thing with vintage style pickups. But I feel like Yngwie and those types of guys, you know, Chris Impellitteri, who else? They can get away with kind of that vintage strat shreddy thing. But if when anyone does that, then they just sound like Yngwie. So he's another guy, kind of like Brian May. So you guys want to see some of my history with shreddy guitars? I don't have a drum roll. Let's see. I'm going to show you my chat now. Shred. Okay. There's the chat that I see. Okay, this is some photos I collected from the past. So, you're probably wondering what this is. So, in South Florida, I played with a band, a cover band, and then we would do like four sets during the gig. And the third set was usually, we would go and dress up as our alter egos, our 80s metal alter egos called Pink Champagne. So the band itself was called Stinky Malone. And we would play in Fort Lauderdale all over the place. And on the third set, we would play four sets. Mind you, the gig started at like 10:30 p.m. until 3 a.m. Those were my working hours. I could do that in my 20s, but if I had to do a gig starting at 10:30 p.m. and work till 3 a.m. now, forget about it. And that was four sets. Maybe it was three sets. But I believe it was either the last set or the second to the last set. We would go to our cars and put on wigs and these stupid clothes. And this guitar was actually my roommate's, or my old roommate's at the time. This was, I think I have a better picture of it here. There we go. It was a brand called Fox, but it was spelled F-O-X-X-E. You gotta have two X's. So whenever you're doing shreddy stuff or 80s metal, you gotta double X's and double like Z's. If you have a Z, you gotta put a bunch of Z's. So this was a Fox guitar with, I don't know, it was like a no-name brand, kind of made in China type of thing. Really bad tremolo, really bad pickup. The pickup was extremely microphonic to the point where I could sing backup vocals by screaming into the humbucker. That's how bad it was. But it worked. Really good neck, you know. But it was more for the look. It was just like lipstick red. I got all of my accessories from Hot Topic. So I had some fishnet hand warmers and these... you know, you got to get the white tiger print and the leopard print strap. This was before I had a lot of tattoos. And that wig, I don't know why I got that wig. I think that was like the last wig that they had at Party City, like right before the gig or something, which was, it was silver, which I don't know who has silver. Well, that was cool. And then I don't know if you can see in the back, but the amp I was playing through was an Engel Screamer, which today, to this day, is like one of my favorite, like medium high gain. It was a high gain amp to me. 50 watts, awesome, workhorse. I spilled so much beer and Jägermeister on it, and it kept on working. Knobs were falling off. It had a mirrored plate, and it all of the controls scratched off, like you couldn't see which one was volume or treble or anything. Yeah, so George Lynch, exactly. I get George Lynch a lot. It's the tan. But, this was an awesome shreddy guitar. Obviously I'm tapping something. I don't know what I was playing. Next picture. I don't even know what order these are in, so bear with me. Oh, okay. This is cute. This is my first band. I don't know if any of my friends from grade school are here. Sometimes the bass player chimes in. This was like the first band, the first gig. It was like a Halloween dance at my school. I think I actually did a reaction video where I showed some of the footage. But that was my second guitar I ever had, which was a Platinum Series BC Rich Warlock. Did anyone have a Platinum Series Warlock, BC Rich back in the 80s? They were crappy guitars. It had like a really bad locking tremolo setup, but I think, you know, you knew it was bad when it wasn't a locking nut. It was just like a locking bracket on the other side of the nut, behind the nut, which didn't work the same as a Floyd for some reason. It kind of defeated the purpose of having, you know, locking trem setup or whatever. Anyways, this guitar never stayed in tune. I sold it, and I think I got like that SG90. But it was a BC Rich Warlock. It was a powder blue BC Rich Warlock. Yeah, and that's me showing the devil horns in that skull mask. This was eighth grade Halloween, so I was 13, 12 or 13 probably. Not eighth grade. I was in seventh grade. Holy shit. Seventh grade. Diana Mata. Didn't want to miss that. Thank you for pointing that out, Ben Tom, as well. Here we go. Good morning, RJ. Please wish my boyfriend Cesar Silvas. Cesar. Happy birthday, Cesar. He recently got a Novo Serus J and won't put it down. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry to hear that. Congratulations, Cesar, on your Novo, and congratulations on your day of birth. Thank you, Diana. Appreciate that. That's awesome. I'm glad everyone's... If you didn't see also, Novo was featured on USA Today about how they have stayed afloat even with the whole pandemic. They didn't close. They were able to figure out, you know, a business plan and schedule that worked for their employees. They didn't furlough or get rid of any of, lay off any of their employees. And it's an amazing, that's why I love them so much. That's why I love the company. Not only do they build good guitars, but it's good people and really a family. So there you go. Okay, is this Baby Guar? I think we were called the Plague. All right, next picture. Yeah, okay, so this is a Flying V. Same band in Florida, Stinky Malone. This is without the clothes. But I got this Flying V. So this was after the Ricky Martin tour. Gibson had loaned me a couple guitars, and they had loaned me this Flying V, and I would take it on my my weekend gigs. And it was cool. It was a nice Shreddy guitar. I think this constitutes being a Shreddy guitar because of the shape. It doesn't have a trem, but I think this gets a pass for sure. Braxel, how are you? Are you having any ribeye in the future? No, I would like a ribeye, or maybe I'll get a hamburger today. It's been a while since I got a nice a burger. Marky FX had a 90 Super Strat BC Rich with Floyd Maple Neck Electric Blue. Yeah, nice. Did it have a reverse headstock? That would be awesome. Blake Hall is back. John Doe, this is an extremely suggestive gesture. Well, you know, this is posing for the camera people. I don't even know who took this picture. Anyways, okay, this is back in the day. This was definitely early 90s. Baggy clothes. That was my one Ibanez that I think I might have shown this before. This is my one Ibanez that I owned. No, I lie. I've owned a couple Ibanezes. Sorry. This is my first Ibanez that I owned. This was a 540 Sabre, a 540S Desert Sun Yellow. This was not the Frank Gambale. This was before they put out the Frank Gambale signature model. But I bought it because I wanted a guitar that looked like Frank Gambale's, which was essentially this thing. Now, the thing with this is kind of like the ultimate 80s shred guitar to me because, A, you got the Wizard neck, which is was known for being like the Shreddy neck because it was so skinny and you could play fast, apparently, which was not true. And then the body, which was a very unique body shape. It was like I call it the pancake guitar because it was so contoured and pancakey and thin in certain places. So super light. But it was a little bit too light, and I could kind of tell tonally that it wasn't, it didn't have great sustain for what it was. But it had the Floyd, and it had, oh wow, I've got the Allen wrench sticking out of the headstock. I didn't notice it. But this guitar is one that I've kind of been looking for. And I can't find it on Reverb. I've seen a couple in different colors, but not this Desert Sun Yellow with the shark tooth inlays. It's got to have the shark tooth inlays. When I think Ibanez shred guitars, it's got to have the shark tooth inlays. I don't know why. Mickey Settlemyer had a 540S in Desert Yellow. Did it have the shark tooth inlays? Angus Clark is here. Did I get rid of this Ibanez? Yes. I'm trying to think. You know what? I think I sold it. I traded it. Okay, yeah, I traded it in. I believe after my first year in college, I came back to Detroit for the summer. And I traded it in for a Mexican Tele with a humbucker in the neck. I feel like I did that because I was getting more into jazz. I was starting to go to University of Miami to study jazz. So I'm like, oh yeah, Telly with a humbucker. I want to be Mike Stern. So I traded that in for the Telly. And then I believe I traded that Telly in for a Ibanez Iceman. And I think, I don't know, does Bent Tom remember when I had the Iceman? That was a good guitar. That's another guitar that I wish I never sold. So the moral of the story is I don't own any Ibanez guitars, and I regret selling all of the Ibanez guitars that I ever had. And you'll see a bunch more in these pictures because look, well, that's not, okay, so this is not my guitar. I just wanted to show you how beautiful this, the colorway of the yellow gem is. More than any other gem that Ibanez and Steve Vai had put out. There's something about the yellow gem with the pink DiMarzios and the green knobs and the maple neck. There's something about this particular one that this says, this screams 80s shred to me. More than the green one, more than the pink one, more than the floral or any universe. So this wasn't my guitar, unfortunately. This was Josh Rand's guitar that I was borrowing when I was subbing for Stone Sour. And the funny story about this was I was using this guitar. It was probably the first or the second gig I was doing with them. And I went for, I think I went for a bend. I went for a bend on like the high E string. And I didn't realize how low his action was. He likes his action pretty low. And I went for a bend and it totally just fretted out. And I went like, and it just like totally stopped. And I was like, oh, it's kind of embarrassing. And then I think I tried to make up for it by, I can't tell if he had a whammy bar. Maybe not. I feel like I tried to go for the whammy bar, but little did I know is that he had his trems blocked off. So the Floyd on his guitar didn't move. It was just kind of there, you know, to be original and for show, but he, you know, probably to be play it safe live, if you're not using it and you don't want it to go out of tune, just block it off, and it, you know, if you break a string, it's cool because it won't go out of tune. Smart move. But I went for it and it did. Didn't go anywhere. I was like, damn, okay. So, pro tip, before you do a gig with somebody else's guitar, spend a couple minutes with it and check it out before you play it, because I didn't, and that's what I get. But am I entertaining? Oh, is Rhett entertaining getting a gem? I think Rhett needs to get the Geo. The new gem, or the new Vi model. Okay, so this was another Ibanez. And I'll get through these because I want to show you some of the guitars and stuff. This was a 7-string. This was the first 7-string Ibanez that I got. It doesn't look like a 7-string from far away, but it's a 7-string. Kind of their base model. It was I needed a 7-string for this particular gig, and I just wanted to get the cheapest one that they had. And luckily, you know, in the early 2000s, Ibanez was selling a bunch of 7-string models like hotcakes, probably because of Korn and Limp Bizkit and all those bands. So the early 2000s was heaven if you wanted a 7-string guitar from Ibanez. But I liked it. It wasn't fine. I eventually traded it in and I got a universe, a gem Steve Vai universe that didn't have a grip. It was black, mirrored pickguard, and I broke the trem on that, or I broke one of the posts of the tremolo because I was wanking it too hard. Anyways, last one. This is a guitar that I just demoed recently, a couple months ago, from RS Guitar Works that made my left-handed twisted Strat, which I love so much, that you saw last week. But they make this 80 shredder, single pickup, single volume Floyd. original Floyd, I should note, reverse headstock. I forget the color that they call it. I think they was called like Eddie Van Pepto or something was the color. Salmon. That's it. That's all the pictures I want to show you. So I want to show you some of my Shreddy guitars. Which ones do you want to see? I'll show you the new one. I was going to show you the new one last, but I might as well. I've been yapping. I don't even know if my amp is turned on. So this, I got used on Reverb, because Reverb's the bomb. Here's a rant. I want to talk about... Remember back in the day, if you're old enough to remember buying stuff on eBay and Amazon and all that stuff, remember how great it was to not have to pay sales tax? Now, I feel like I just realized it this month. You're paying sales tax now everywhere. Amazon, Reverb, eBay. And it kind of ruins, like, I don't know if it ruins it, but it was so nice to not have to pay sales tax, right? Am I right? Or am I not right? I'm not warmed up, so don't ask me to really play fast stuff. Okay, let's go to camera two, because I got two cameras, y'all. Hi. The color difference between these two cameras is kind of annoying. I think it's a lighting thing. Camera one, camera two, camera one. I gotta adjust. If anyone, Rhett Schull, if you know how to, I feel like I have the same profiles. This is a Sony and that's a Sony. I feel like I have the same profiles, but for some reason, I think it's the lens is different. So it's making it look a different color. This is a Nash Guitars S-81. So the S-81s are the super strats that they do. Strat body, flat radius, fingerboard. I want to say it's a 12 inch radius, but I could be wrong. Godot Floyd, which I'm not sure if I like the Godot Floyds, but, I set it up yesterday and I set it up hastily. So it's not the greatest setup. I kind of have to adjust the springs here. The cool thing is it did come with a trem blocker, which is nice if you want it to just dive only. But I like it floating, so I took it off. And I'm probably going to install a tremolo, an all-parts tremolo. And maybe I'll do a video on that. But DiMarzio Super Distortion, which I'm actually digging in this guitar. I had a super distortion in an old Rock and Roll Relics guitar, which was okay. But in that guitar, I didn't like it as much as I like it in this guitar. I don't know the single coil, but that's a DiMarzio. This, I believe, is a Super 3, which is kind of the neck version, I think. It's the neck version of the super distortion bridge, whatever that means. Pull pot to do the splitting on both humbuckers. Which never sounds good to me. I don't know about you guys, but for some reason, split humbuckers, I haven't found the perfect split humbucker sound. If anyone has any suggestions, I had inquired about Fralin unbuckers, but somebody was telling me that it sounds great split, but as a regular humbucker, it's gonna leave you wanting more. So if anyone knows how to make a Seymour Duncan JB split really good, let me know, because that's what I'm looking for. Okay. It Yeah, Red Shell, I can't stand split or tapped humbuckers. They just don't sound right. I agree. I have not met a split humbucker that I liked. And there's probably some physics behind it, but I wonder if there's something you can put, like a cap or a resistor or something to, you know, make it so when you do split it, it makes it sound better or something. I would think Bent Tom would know. Braxel, I bought an Ibanez Pia in white. Should I take it back because it's too much sig? No, dude, keep it. I think I said Gia. I meant Pia. Chris R is asking, is shredder tone mostly just distortion and delay? I want to say yeah. Sometimes reverb. Krenar is asking, is it tuned down a half step? You must be playing along. Yeah, I tuned down to E flat on my shreddy guitars. I don't know why. It's just an Eddie thing, I guess. And I put 9.5s on here, which I'm not sure if I like. I kind of just want straight up 9 to 42 and just make it really slinky. So people are scared of Floyd Roses, which they should be because they are weapons of mass destruction. So the thing about Floyds is to get them to stay in tune, the trick is basically whenever you change strings or retune your guitar, like say if you're going from E flat to E, or if you're changing your string gauge or anything like that, you want to be able to block off the trem so it doesn't move while you're making those changes. And then once you make those changes and tune up, you unblock it and you basically readjust the screws to basically move the trem back to its, you know, parallel position, and in turn it kind of brings the guitar back in tune. Sometimes it's not totally perfect, that's why there's fine tuners, but for the most part that's how you get a Floyd to work properly. That's the key, is to block it off when you're retuning or changing whatever. And you know, people have tricks where you put, you know, picks or coins in here, and I've done that and it works fine, but I think I'm gonna try to put the tremolo system in, which allows you to block it off, and then you have an option to make it dive only and return back to zero, or you can have an option to make it floating, which is extremely exciting to me. I think I should make a video on it because that's awesome. It's a great concept. Hopefully, does anyone have one of those tremolos on their Floyd guitars? Let me know how it is. I bought mine 2 years ago. It's still in its package. And I haven't put it on yet because I was going to put it on this one, which is my another great shreddy guitar, which I'll show you in a second. But I haven't yet, so I figured I'll try it on this one. Somebody was asking me, what am I getting to get my tone? So I'm running right now through the clean channel of the Sur, and I'm using a Rev G3 distortion pedal. I'm going through an Ocean's 11 Electro-Harmonics reverb pedal for some plate reverb. And then my Nemesis delay. So Ben Coombs has a Futone trem stop on my Kramer. That's another thing I wanted to look at, if you guys have experience with the Futone stuff. You know, I know they make the blocks, but they also make their own bridges now. But yeah, you can see I still have the little bracket of the trem stop that came with the guitar. But I wanted it floating, so I took it out, or at least a little screw out. Okay, LPD, Lawrence is saying, you didn't like the one that I installed. Even unlocked, it interferes with the smoothness of the trim. So when you say the smoothness, you mean the feel of the bar? Does it make it tighter or something? Angus wants to hear with the LPD 87. You got it, man. So here's the rev. It's a little bit more modern and bright. Here's the LPD. A little warmer. Solo, I should have learned. What's that middle part? You could probably play that. God, I'm sweating. Vito Brada makes me sweat. Woo! What was I talking about? We were talking about something before White Lion. Gotta rewind. Okay, Lawrence Petras was talking about the tremolo. It was interfering somewhere. The one I had, it I installed it on Ibanez Edge, and it had a bit of drag. Interesting. Braxel, if you trem block like you're suggesting, will it be easy to remove without any holes in the guitar, or change it where you can see where it's done? Well, so the basic trem block, which is basically like a bracket and a screw, this is actually screwed into the body. As far as I know, the tremolo, you're basically, I think you're just replacing the claw, right? And then there's like a little device, if I'm not, that takes the place of one of the springs, I think. I'm wondering. No, because I have, okay, I have two things. I've got the trem stopper, which I haven't installed in anything, and a tremolo, which I haven't installed. So I'm getting both of those kind of confused. The tremolo, I think, is pretty non-destructive, as far as I know. I don't know. I've never done it. Lawrence Petras. You don't have to re-drill anything, right? Angus saying, let's you and me watch the Ben Eller tutorial and we can have a playoff a month. That's right. Ben Eller knows all of those solos.
Yeah.
wish Brad Gillis would hop on the chat. But I'm really digging this guitar. It's not 100% perfect, but again, I bought it used, sight unseen. I am planning on doing a little bit of modifications to it. I'm not sure yet, but I might change the pickups out. I might look into changing this trem out to maybe a Floyd or a Futone. But it's a great starting point. The neck is great. Whoa, I just hit this. The neck is great. It doesn't have a huge relicking on the body, but the neck has a really nice rawness. Why can't I see on my screen? It's a little raw. This feels good. The frets are jumbo frets, and I'm not a big fan of jumbo frets, just because when I play chords down here, I have to make sure that I'm not over putting too much pressure, or else it'll be out of tune. Which, you know, I don't have any other guitars that have jumbo frets, so it's like I got to change my playing when I play this guitar. Here's another Shredder guitar that I was saying that a Shredder guitar has to have a trem, and this is the one of the exceptions. Charvel Jake, hardtail, slanted singles. This I actually bought. I traded a guitar with Christian from Stone Sour. I traded my Les Paul Custom for this, and I love this guitar. It's kind of got this, it still has this vintage-y feel, even though I think the radius is 10 or 12. Kind of a narrower, very stratty neck to me. It's very but it's like kind of a bare bones shreddy guitar. You know, there's no trem. I'm pretty much using the humbucker all the time. There's single volume, which is way down here, which is nice and comfortable. The only thing I don't like about this guitar is this one position. The second position is pretty much useless. It's just like, I don't know if it's a phasing thing or what. And it's very noisy, microphonic. I think Christian, this came with a JB originally, and I believe he put in a Duncan Custom, so it's a little bit different. Is pretty awesome. So you kind of can get that traditional stratty tones out of it, but at the same time, it just has the hot bridge. Rootex playing his white Charvel. There you go. This is not just white, though. This is like pearl. I forget the name of it. But basically, in different lights, you can't really tell. In certain lights, it kind of has a purple tinge to it. And then certain lights, it looks white. Which is awesome when you're playing outside. It's cool. Can't really tell on this camera. Maybe you can tell on camera, too. No, that looks just dead. No, I can't see the purple. Or maybe there. Can you see a little bit purple shining through? Maybe. Not so much here. Not so much here. Just right here. Incandescent pearl. Baka at the moon. Doug Doppler. But this is a cool guitar. When I was touring with Thompson Square, when I was playing with Thompson Square, I was using this guitar a lot, which was, it was cool because, you know, I'm using an 80s metal guitar in a country gig. But it made a great touring guitar because it was hardtail, so if I broke a string, didn't have to worry about anything. It looked cool. I played this at the Grand Ole Opry once, and I always say that this was probably the only time a Charvel Jake E Lee has graced the stage at the Opry, which is probably true, because I don't know anyone else in Nashville that has that guitar. Pearlescent, Truth Street. Now, might as well show you this one. This piece of work, which I never really play much, but it still has my drum pad that I haven't taken off from that video I did. So this is a 7-string Kiesel multiscale. I think it needs the rev for this one. This is another stunning looking guitar. I bought this on their, you know, guitars in stock, ready to go. It's got the Fishman Fluence pickups, modern, and they painted them to match the body color, which I thought was interesting. Not that I really cared, but that was a plus. But yeah, it's a 7-string, multi-scale, fan frets. I've never owned one. I kind of wanted to see what all the hubbub was about. But I was actually, when I got it, I was really impressed with these Fishman pickups. This is probably the most modern guitar that I own, as far as like all the bells and whistles with the fan frets and the active pickups and whatnots. Somebody heard the lick. Did I play the lick? Now this actually has, I don't know if they call it coils. It's not coil splitting because these are weird pickups. But whether it's tapped or coil split, I don't know. But these actually sound decent to me. So in the middle position especially, let me see if I can make it sound pretty. Humbucker. I pull it. Have that modern kind of tone to it. I can't really get a vintagey sound out of it that I like, at least. Mm-hmm. But these are the Fluence Moderns, so it's supposed to... I sold my other Kiesel. If you didn't know, I sold my headless, the Alan Holdsworth guitar. So if whoever bought it is here in the chat, congratulations. I hope you enjoy it, and I hope you use it more than I did. Actually, I got some pretty good use out of that guitar. I mean, it was my fly date guitar. So I took it on the road whenever I would fly anywhere to do a gig because I was lazy. And I wanted to avoid getting in fights with flight attendants about bringing my guitar on board. And it totally solved that issue. I didn't have any problems bringing that guitar on any flights. Meanwhile, my bandmates would get in fights all the time. Me, it just looked like a ukulele. It was awesome. So it made touring a little bit easier. But at the same time, it looked weird. But I didn't care at the time. It still sounded fine. It was a pleasure to play. But I couldn't get past the looks. And since I'm not touring anymore, I didn't think I needed it, that guitar anymore. So I let it go. But this one is the last one I'm going to show you. This one is a special one because... So when I got called to do the Stone Sour gig... I looked at my gear, I'm like, what the hell am I going to bring? I don't have cool hard rock metal guitars. So I went to the guitar center here in Nashville. I was just looking to see what they had. And they had this kind of on clearance. This is a Music Man JP16, John Petrucci model with the Floyd. I kind of didn't want the Floyd, but I picked it up and I played it. And it's, you can see, it's got a really beautiful, maybe you can't see on that. The neck is really nice, kind of that bird's eye thing. It's really skinny and really thin, which I was kind of surprised. I think I've talked about this in the past, but I always think of Petrucci as being like a huge hulking bearded guy now. So to know that he plays like such a skinny neck, it's kind of weird. But yeah, so I bought this to play on the gig, and I enjoyed it so much I kept it. I'm like, this is a really nice guitar for what it is. It's built well. Everyone knows that the Music Man stuff is built really well, especially like the premium stuff. I mean, this wasn't cheap, but it wasn't like, you know, the, what is it, Ball Family Reserve stuff. Amazing fretwork, stainless steel frets. This is a Floyd Rose Pro. I don't know if you can see, but this is my favorite Floyd Rose tremolo. And I lucked out. I still don't know to this day anything about Floyd Rose things or the different models, but I know I like this one. Once I figured out how to get to set up the Floyds and get them to stay in tune, literally this doesn't go out of tune. And it's super, super loose to the point where if I pick too hard, I mean, it flutters a lot, which might not be the greatest thing, but the fact that it flutters that much and still stays in tune pretty good, more than any other Floyd Rose guitar I've ever had. And another thing that I like about this is the Floyd Rose Pro, and I guess with this model, they put the fine tuners at the very end, which I like because when I'm palm muting or have my hand on this part of the bridge, sometimes like on my on the pink guitar, I'll feel my palm rub up against the fine tuners and I'll freak out about the tuning. With this, you don't have that problem because the tuners are way here, all the way at the end, so you're not going to bump into it. So it's a better design. I don't know if that makes a difference. anything about these pickups, but I'm assuming these are his signature pickups. I guess DiMarzio's. But it's got a preamp built in, which I don't use, because how much gain do you really need? You can tell when it's clean. Then you can, when you're in the middle position, and you can split the coils. This trim is set up really, really loose, so you got to be careful with it when you're... Yeah, Steve from Boston. I started the stream with a little Toots country road song. And I also like the ability to change the tension or the tightness of the arm. You know, some of the other ones you have to screw in and they get tight at a certain point. This one you can kind of adjust the little the nut here, so you can make it really free flowing, or you can tighten it up and have it like stay in one place, which is, I like that. So I'm considering putting this exact trem in the pink guitar. I'm assuming it's gonna fit, but I don't know. Oh, my dad is watching. Teresa says, say hi to dad when you're finished shredding. He's watching. Hi, dad. Good morning. What'd you have for breakfast? I have 50 guitars. We talk about how many guitars I have all the time. Let's take some questions. Peter P. Is this my friend Peter P.P.? Parente? No, those are Novos. What are those? What are those guitars? Ah, you're hiding from me. Which App Nation was your favorite out of the ones you tested? Looking to get one. My top two. So I decided to get the Steel String Sultan, which is the pink one back there, which is just a clean amp, pretty much. There's no overdrive in it. But it's, to me, it has the best clean I've ever I've heard from an amp. And it can be clean. It doesn't sound anemic. It's weird to explain. And it's weird. It's hard to understand if you've never played an amp like this, because, you know, a lot of people play clean amps, maybe like a cranked Fender with a little bit of drive, but never just like a pure, pristine, clean that sounds good with their guitars. And for some reason, this one in particular, the Sultan, sounded great, especially with my strats. And I could turn it up pretty loud. It's not a super, super high wattage amp. I want to say it's only... I got the lower wattage one. But for what I do in recording, it's just got a really nice full sound for a clean sound. And it takes pedals great. And the second one I like was the Bombshell Overdrive. That one I really liked. To be honest, if I could just use those two amps and just kind of switch between them as my clean and my dirty, I would probably go with those two amps. So, but they're all great. I mean, I'm demoing the Wonderland Overdrive this weekend, and I've also played the Amplifonics in Gain. But definitely the Steel String Sultan and the Bombshell were my favorites. Oh gosh, Teresa Ronquillo. Dr. Ronquillo is also the king of karaoke, I hear. You have no idea. Oh, he's got trophies. Dad has trophies and medals from karaoke. Yeah, Browns fan. I send links to my well, at least my dad every Saturday, so he remembers to watch. Braxel, can we see the settings on the Rev? Oh, first, let me say hi to Ted Nagurski. Sorry, I didn't see that. Do I get to keep all the gear you demo? Not all of it. Sometimes, even with pedals, sometimes they send me the prototype or their, you know, the only production model that they have, which sometimes I'll have to send it to like Sean Tubbs or something, so it'll get passed around. And some of them I keep, some of the pedals I keep. Amps and guitars I usually send back. But it really depends. But a lot of times, you know, especially if they're from overseas, the cost of shipping a pedal back and forth is not worth it, so they just let me keep it. Braxel wants to see the settings on the Rev G3 pedal. I can't show it to you, but it's basically, so I have it on the blue switch, which is kind of like the mid gain. And then everything is pretty much on 12. I put the middle down a little bit and I put the bass up a little bit and I put the treble and the bass are a little past 12 and the mids are a little below 12. I usually start at 12, and that's what it sounds like. I've got some chorus. Does anyone know who played that riff? Or name the riff and name the player. I'll wait. See ya, PDX Guitar Freak. Yes, Rhett Shell got the, a Wonderland Overdrive to demo as well. There we go. BC Rich, Teresa, Lawrence Petras, Black Cat, Nuno Betancourt played that riff. At least the solo, right? Matt Bradford, what's up, man? You did the Fuzz Face shootout with your dude Brett Papa before you got your Sun Face. Does the Sun Face rule them all? Well, Matt, good to see you. So I put the Sun Face on my main big board, the Vertex board, because I liked it so much. And it was just a good go-to fuzz. Basically, three favorite fuzzes is the Sun Face, the Jesse Davey Kingtone Fuzz, and then I like the Silicon Fuzz from Espresso Effects. Yes. So I basically have three favorite fuzz faces, despite having 10 fuzz faces. I narrowed it down to three favorite ones. Okay. Ted Nagurski. Some questions coming in. I'll stream for, another 10 minutes. What's the weirdest piece of gear you've ever demoed? Was it the Farmer Backbeat foot drum? So if you're not familiar with the Farmer Backbeat, and I'll talk about this in a video coming up. I used to be in a one-man band with myself, and I had this device called the Farmer Backbeat, which was basically a drum set that you would wear on your back, a backpack drum set, which I still have. It's not operational right now, but maybe I'll get it operational and show it to you. Yeah, that was probably the weirdest piece of gear. Because, I mean, it wasn't a guitar thing, but it was an instrument. And I not only did I make a video, like a short video about it, but I demoed it at the NAMM show in, 2013 or something. And I had to wear that the whole day long. And I worked that NAMM show for their booth, Farmer Foot Drums, all 4 days. And I had to, I didn't have to, but I did wear it. And it's heavy. It's not light. But it got some interest. No one, I mean, it was just, it was kind of interesting to watch. But it was definitely, you know, a specific style of instrument. Look it up. Farmer Backbeat foot drum. I saw some other questions. I feel like I missed them. My secret machine. I don't know much about nitro versus poly. I mean, I have guitars with both. I do kind of like the feel of nitro more than poly, but it really doesn't bother me. It's not a huge factor. Okay, Krenar. I know Krenar is working on some YouTube stuff. I'm trying to find that comment so I can highlight you. Here we are. Everyone go follow Krenar Silco Guitars channel. He's a new guitar YouTuber. He's asking, when did you feel comfortable to contact companies for collabs? I reached out to one, got denied. Would love to know when it would be reasonable to try again. That's a good question. To tell you the truth, I don't really think I was reaching out to companies more. It was more that they were reaching out to me. And then once I felt like I had built up my content on YouTube and my resume or whatever, then I think I started contacting companies. But I feel like the majority of work was because companies came to me. And I mean, a lot of it has to do with, you know, I started doing that 10 years ago. So, you know, luckily I've been in the YouTube game for a while, and it was a different time back then. So it's kind of the Wild West. It's way different than it is today. I would say my recommendation is to, you know, just start making videos of the gear that you already have and just, you know, build up your channel so you have content already there, and hopefully you'll get some views, or you'll have a certain style of video that is different than other YouTubers or whatever. And then, you know, eventually start hitting up like pedal companies or whatever and saying, hey, I'm interested in demoing a particular pedal. And maybe sometimes it helps to already own a particular company's pedal and tell them that you're a fan of their stuff and you'd like to demo some other model that they have. But that's after you build up your content on YouTube. And, you know, Instagram is another great way to have a presence, because I feel like a lot of companies kind of look at Instagram and YouTube as far as ways that they can promote their products. So I would start there, but that's a good question. Never really thought about that. But don't let, you know, getting a denied letter set you back. It's especially nowadays, it's after the pandemic and all these musicians who are not touring anymore, a lot of them jumped on YouTube and started live streaming and starting getting into gear demos or lesson videos or whatever. So don't feel like you have to be limited to just doing gear demos or product demos. You can think about doing other guitar related stuff, repair stuff or whatever. I mean, I don't just do gear demos. I try to do a bunch of things related to guitar. So, and that's more for me because I'm interested in all that kind of stuff as well. Good questions, guys. OCE pedals. I just saw you. I just saw that. Thank you. Did I pronounce it right? OCE? Long time listener, first time commenter. Here's some money for lunch. Just say thanks. Oh, I appreciate that, man. Where are you? There you are. OCE pedals. I'm assuming you make pedals. I'll check them out. Thanks, man. I appreciate that. But yeah, Krenard, there's a couple people that are chiming in that have some tips as well. I'll answer a couple questions. Pete Bialk, yes. I don't even have to ask that question. Would you ever consider a collab with National Coney Island? Yeah. I think I still have a National Coney Island shirt that my friend gave me for my birthday. It's funny that as soon as I said National Coney Island, my stomach started grumbling. So I think that's a sign I need some Coney dogs. Matt Harrison has a great tip. Use hashtags on Instagram to increase your reach. I mean, hashtag, don't overdo it. I probably overdo it sometimes. But hashtags are just a way sometimes to easily connect to the company or the product that you're talking about. I don't know a lot about hashtags. I kind of just copy and paste the ones I've used before. So all right, guys, any more questions? I'm gonna say goodbye in about 5 minutes. Let me take that other guitar. You guys name this guitar. Give me some name suggestions. It's pink. I kind of already have a name for this guitar, but I want to see what you guys suggest. What do you guys think? What's the first thing that comes to your mind when you see this? I like it with that chorus. I don't know why. Steve from Boston says, Pinky Tuscadero. You know, Susie Quattro is from my hometown in Grosse Pointe, Michigan. Susie Quattro is Leather Tuscadero. Nashville Pinky, Pink Menace, Pinkilla. Painkilla wants me to call it Pinkilla. Pinkilio, Pinky and the Brain. Call it Vicks because it'll cure everything. Pinky Rockadero, Pinky Van Halen. So many. Peptulio. Everyone's digging Pinky Tuscadero. Double Bubble. Pepto Shredder. Pink Panther. Pepto Dismal. Thank you. Westone 66, do I know John 5? No, we've never met. He graduated from high school, we attended the same high school, but he had graduated a couple years before me. I mean, like, how old is John Lowry now? He's probably like 7 or 8 years older than me, so we didn't go to the same high school. Teresa says, my niece says it looks like Pinkie Pie from My Little Pony. Thank you for letting me know, because I don't know anything about My Little Pony. Pinkie Pie! I don't know, I'm going with Pinkie Pie. For Braxel, the chorus I'm using is from the GFI Synesthesia. It's a pedal that has a ton of effects, but I'm just using just the chorus, and it sounds pretty good. So what is this called? Pinkie Pie? Pete Bialk, yes, John 5 went to South, but it wasn't called South. It was just called Grosse Pointe High School at the time. You know what? How old is... Someone tell... Look up how old is John 5, John Lowry. Because I feel... He's probably like 8 years older than me or something. When was he born? But yeah, we went to the same high school. Went to North. I think you told me that. Yeah, I don't think he talks about being from Michigan a lot. But there, I remember, I think he posted it, but there was a picture of him when he was a kid, and he looks total Grosse Pointe. He's probably wearing like a polo shirt with the collar popped, like 80s Grosse Pointe. He's 49, born in 71. So yeah, he's, when was I born? He's 5 years older than me. So he would have graduated 2 years before I would have gotten into high school. 2 or 3 years, yeah. Man, there's a lot of people born in 71. Shit. Sorry. Shoot. Um, 49. Okay. Good to know. Thank you for looking it up. Pipioc just found out his cousin went to school with him. That's awesome. So what, he would have graduated in 88? Is that right? 87, 88, somewhere like that. And then probably went straight to LA after that. So he was gone when I was probably still playing that powder blue BC Rich guitar that you saw earlier today. Oh, I can't beat that. Dan Huffman. I'm 76, my secret. Check out that rig rundown. I will. Cody Leroy, favorite high gain pedal. My favorite is the LPD 87, which is this pedal. because it can sound modern, but it also has that vintagey kind of, you know, modded Marshall sound. Obviously not now, I'm using chorus. Alright guys, I'm gonna head out. I'm out of coffee. No, I'm not. Have a great day, Pete Bialk. Enjoy the Michigan weather. Truth Street, when is my premier guitar rig rundown? You know what? They had contacted me right before, you know, quarantine, and they wanted to come over and film stuff, but then quarantine hit, and I know they were doing kind of remote rig rundowns, which I guess I would have had that option, but I, you know, I'll wait till they can come over. So hopefully soon I will talk to the PG people. Low gain overdrive, Sus Mariosip, all day long. Actually, I've never tried it out with this guitar. Played this guitar with anything but high gain, so this is new. Pickups sound pretty good. Thanks for hanging out, guys. I got a new video for you on Tuesday that I'm excited to show you. Is it Tuesday? And, yeah, I'm working on some other stuff. I'm going to go get some tacos or hamburgers or something today for lunch. Smash the like button, Steve, and slap like and smash it. Headbang the like button, would you please? Thanks for hanging out, guys. Don't forget to follow me on the Instagrams. I've actually got a new setup that I'm trying to do Instagram lives, but with better quality audio. Hopefully audio like this, but on my Instagram live. So maybe I'll try it out later today, tomorrow, or whatever. Don't forget to check out Retchel's Backstage Live show today. I think it's going to be exciting, as my dad would say. Yeah, stay safe, stay, healthy, listen to some Toots and the Maytals today, and, I'll see you next week. Joe Coy. Sus Mariosip!